So much for taking time on this Sunday morning to be in the house of the Lord, to join with his people in praise, to hear the word of God, let it convict us of our sins and lift us up by God's grace. I would love it if you let us know that you are with us this morning, whether you're out on our live stream or here in person. The best thing to do at this point in time is to get ready to fill out our worship connection card. If you're here in the building, just take out your smartphone, scan the code on the card that's right in front of you. If you're out there, on our live stream, you can click on the link down in the comment section, and that will lead you over to our Worship Connection card, where it asks for things like your name, how we can be in touch with you, and if there's any other way that we as a congregation might be able to serve your spiritual needs here at St. Paul's. We'd love to hear from you on our Worship Connection card. Another thing that we do every time we get together is we receive an offering. Now, this is normal for congregations, but St. Paul's does it in a little bit of a different way. Instead of having the ushers pass a plate during the worship service, we have an offering plate that's out by the hymnal and Bible trolley out there in the narthex. So if you've brought an offering with you today, you can leave it there, and we will employ it in the kingdom of God to the best of our ability. If instead you prefer to give electronically, there's information about how to do so on St. Paul's website. You can access that at spalutheran.org/give. Couple things about St. Paul's worship life in the coming weeks. First, I want to alert you to something that's happening about a month from now. We have our Gathering Sunday, which is an annual event where we worship remotely. That's not just for you guys out there in the live stream. We leave 149 Lake Avenue and make a huge pilgrimage all the way down the hill to High Rock Park. And there we have worship outside, followed up by a church barbecue. It's a really wonderful time. This year, we're also going to have have our backpack blessing for kids as they're going back to school at that point in time. I know summer's only 6 weeks old, right? It's only 6 weeks old and we've only got 6 weeks left. So folks, it's time to be thinking about our fall effect in that way. So the Gathering Sunday kicks off our program year every year, and we'd love to invite you to that. If you prefer worshiping in the building on that Saturday evening, there is also a worship service at 4 p.m. on Saturday where we don't go down to the park. But I hope that you will, because I've invited them on Saturday night to join us down there. So it'd be great to have as many people as we possibly can down at the park. Another thing that is coming this fall is our serving challenge. I love these 40-day challenges because they give us an opportunity to reflect deeply on our faith and to put it into practice. The joy of serving is something that is hard to describe, but it's something that's kind of addictive. When you know that you've done something right and you've blessed somebody and you know that God has been working through you, you want more of that. And so our serving challenge is a season that we are dedicating in the fall of this year in order in worship and in personal devotions and in small groups to get together and process what it means to be a servant of Christ and how Christ came as a servant for us. As he said, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. And since we are made in the image of Jesus, and the word Christian just means little Christ, that's really what we are called to do as well. We are called to serve as well. And as Jesus served with joy, and for the joy that was set before him, that's what we get out of that practice as well. So a couple things about that. In the coming weeks, we're going to be having our book sales. These are the devotional books that will lead us through the 40-day experience. They're available for $5. And starting a couple of weekends from now, there are going to be book sales out in the narthex after every worship service until the serving challenge starts. So you've got a long time to kind of get yourself into that. So whenever you're here over the coming month and a half, you'll be able to pick up that book and get ready for it that way. But another part and parcel of our small group process, of our serving challenge process, is the small groups. Small groups are a really wonderful opportunity to build connections with one another, to support one another in your journey through the serving challenge. And we are forming small groups. Actually, even as we speak, there are 14, perhaps 15 small groups already established. And you have the ability, when you purchase that book, to go and say, I want to be a part of this one. And it may be based on where you live and where that group is, or it may be based on your affinities or your age group or whether there are kids or childcare involved. There's a lot of different ways that you can identify into those small groups. But we hope that everybody in the congregation will take advantage of that. Now, if everybody in the congregation takes advantage of the small groups, we're going to need some more. And so maybe you've already heard me say, the Lord lifts up those whom he equips, those he will, he doesn't always call the equipped. It's a hard thing. God doesn't always call the equipped, but he always equips the called. So maybe you are being called to be a small group host or a small group facilitator. Both of these are simple ways that you could support that serving challenge effort. And so if you are interested in that, we will help you get up into those roles. So just tug on my sleeve or send me an email and we'll get you pointed in the right direction that way. Okay, enough about worship up in the future. Now we're talking about worship today. We are half and half blended service, so the beginning is a contemporary feel. The latter part of the service uses Lutheran service book Divine Service 3 as our guide for receiving the sacrament of Christ's body and blood, which we're looking forward to receiving at our altar today. So if you like to worship with the screens and like that heads-up worship effect, all you need to do is lift up your eyes and lift up your voice and sing. If you prefer a book, however, there is a trolley of those hymnals and Bibles out there in the narthex, and I will not be offended if you go out and grab one for yourself so that you might be able to follow along with your eyes in the book. Some people prefer it in that way. So, with all of that said, may I invite you now to stand and join in the gathering prayer to orient our hearts appropriately for worship in this coming hour. Let us pray together. O Lord, my Creator, Redeemer, and Comforter, as I come to worship you in spirit and in truth, I humbly pray that you would open my heart to the preaching of your word so that I may repent of my sins, believe in Jesus Christ as my only Savior, and grow in grace and holiness. Hear me for the sake of his name. Amen. We join in our opening song, You Are Holy. God bless your worship this morning. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days.
All of my days.
I will say a prayer and I worship.
You are my
of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
I call down the name of the Lord.
O Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief.
The Lord has dealt bountifully with us.
The Lord has opened our ears.
The Lord has delivered us from death.
He wipes away tears from all faces.
He rescues our feet from stumbling.
And restores our tongues to proclaim his good news.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together.
Lord Jesus Christ, our support and defense in every need, continue to preserve your church in safety. Govern her by your goodness. And bless her with your peace. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated to hear the word of the Lord.
Sorry. The Old Testament reading for today is from Isaiah chapter 50. The Lord God has given me the tongue of those who are taught, that I may know how to sustain with a word him who is weary. Morning by morning he awakens. He awakens my ear to hear as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I turned not backward. I gave my back to those who strike, and my cheeks to those who pull out the beard. I hid not my face from disgrace and spitting. But the Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who is my adversary? Let him come near to me. Behold, the Lord God helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Behold, all of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. Who among you fears the Lord and obeys the voice of his servant? Let him who walks in darkness and has no light trust in the name of the Lord and rely on his God. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from James chapter 3. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For we all stumble in many ways, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle his whole body. If we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire, and the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, bear olives, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a salt pond yield fresh water. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite the congregation to stand in honor of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is according to St. Mark in the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now, when Peter, James, and John came with Jesus to the other disciples, they saw a great crowd around them and scribes arguing with them. And immediately all the crowd, when they saw Jesus, were greatly amazed and ran up to him and greeted him. And he asked them, "What are you arguing about with them?" And someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought my son to you, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. So I asked your disciples to cast it out, but they were not able." And he answered them, "Oh, faithless generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me." And they brought the boy to him. And when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. And has often cast him into fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Jesus said, "If you can, all things are possible for one who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, "I believe, help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." And after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out. And the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said, "He's dead." But Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. And when he had entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" And he said to them, "This kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We sing in confession.
Jesus, I've forgotten the words that you have spoken, promises that burned within my heart have now grown dim. With a doubting heart I follow the paths of earthly wisdom. Forgive me for my
on our behalf, we still struggle with sin in our lives. Our tongues still curse. Our feet still stumble. Our ears still listen to lies and gossip. We still disbelieve. Nevertheless, our Heavenly Father invites us to come to Him for forgiveness. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and our neighbors in what we have said and what we have left unsaid. We have neglected opportunities to share your love. We have stumbled and fallen into sin again and again. Forgive us for Jesus' sake. Lord, we believe. Help our unbelief. Amen. May God be merciful to you and strengthen your faith Do you believe that the forgiveness I speak is not my forgiveness, but God's?
Yes, I believe.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, hear and trust in the word of our Lord. All things are possible for one who believes. So let it be done for you as you believe. Almighty God, in his boundless love, sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die and rise for our forgiveness and eternal life. Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's share that peace with one another.
Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from my persecutors.
Make your face shine on your servants. Save me in your steadfast love. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning,
is now, and will be forever.
Amen. Grace and mercy and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Well, after about a month and change in Mark chapter 6, we have jumped over Mark chapter 7 and chapter 8 and the beginning of chapter 9, and a lot of things have happened in that time. And the reason that we are making that skip in this gospel according to St. Mark is because if we were following along in the lectionary, the appointed readings for the church year. For some unknown reason, the people that created the lectionary stopped their versions of, they stopped reading Mark, and they went over to the Gospel of John and spent 3 weeks in John chapter 6 about Jesus being the bread of life. I don't understand it. So what we're going to do is we're going to use some of the readings that are would have been a part of our consideration during the serving challenge for the next 3 weeks. So you get a little bit of fruit basket mix up, but the stories are still good. So let me give you a little bit of meanwhile back on the ranch so that you can know where we are in the story of the gospel according to St. Mark. So Jesus, you might remember in chapter 6 of Mark, commissions his disciples to go out and drive out demons and heal diseases in his name. And they do it. It's an incredible thing. Jesus has fed the 5,000 people, and he's on his way to visit where the disciples have gone on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And you might recall that Jesus was walking on the water that made Peter and the other disciples shriek in terror because they thought they had seen a ghost. And Jesus said to them, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." It's a wonderful way to leave off of the gospel according to St. Mark in chapter 6, because there are plenty of things that could inspire fear. These wondrous works of Jesus are mind-blowingly good that you can't know whether to smile or to kind of cringe. You're not sure who you're dealing with, except it becomes clear who you're dealing with. This is the Son of God. This is God walking on earth. This news lands as good news for some and really awful news for others. And chapters 7 and 8 tell the story of how this contradiction against Jesus finally makes its way out into the public view. The opposition to his mission and ministry from scribes and teachers of the law and from demons continues to increase. At the same time, at the beginning of the Gospel according to St. Mark chapter 9, Jesus takes Peter and James and John on a hike. And they climb the mountain that we have come to know as the Mount of Transfiguration. And up on the top of the mountain, just to demonstrate who he is and what he's able to do, Jesus peels back his human form for just a minute and has a conversation with Moses and Elijah, both of whom had died a very long time before, the kind of pillars of the Old Testament. Peter, James, and John were witness to these things, and it made them stammer in fear because they beheld God face to face. And that doesn't bode well for people usually. So Peter suggests that they make some tents, more for his sake so he can hide than for Jesus' sake so he has a place to stay. But then Jesus returns to his mild-mannered Judean first century self, and they start the hike down the mountain, and he tells them something a little bit odd. Don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody what you've seen. Meanwhile, back on the ranch, the disciples who had been commissioned to drive out demons were busy in the town of Capernaum trying to do that very thing and failing. The scribes took note of this. The crowds took note of this. But more to the point, the dad in the story took note of this, that the disciples whom Jesus had previously commissioned to go and do work in his name weren't able to do the work in his name. Their arms were too short. They just couldn't do it. And so the dad pipes up from the crowd, "Listen, I brought my kid to you. He's in really bad shape. He's got a demon that makes him mute and foam at the mouth and grow rigid. He has seizures. It's horrible." And they throw him into the fire and into the water. They're trying to kill him, but your disciples can't help. Have you ever been in a situation where you felt like your arms were too short? Something happened that you could not fix. I've been there. Sometimes it's at the bedside of a congregation member where what they've heard from the doctors is too much for me. I can't help that. Or someone comes into my office and says, "Pastor, My husband, my wife said, it's over. What am I going to do? My arms are too short for that. We were expecting a baby, and we miscarried. What's next? My kids won't talk to me. Pastor, I don't know how I'm going to... My arm's too short. Your arm's too short. This is the story of Mark chapter 9. Jesus asked a question in this story that gives us a little peek into how awful and terrible our ancient foe, the devil, is. Jesus said, how long has this been happening to him? And what did the man say? Since he was a little kid. The devil picks awful fights. He doesn't fight fair. And you can tell what his goal is by what he did to that child. Not just making him fall on the ground and foam at the mouth, but throwing him into fire and water in his seized condition. He's trying to kill him. This is the work of the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he will devour, St. Peter reminds us. And you know who he wants to devour? You. Me. Anybody on whom Christ has had compassion. He hates us. But Jesus loves us. And he loves us in incredibly compassionate and powerful ways at the same time. We tend to think of compassion as soft, tender. There. It'll be okay. But when the Father cries out to Jesus, if you can do anything, have compassion and show mercy to us. What does Jesus do? He grits his teeth and he speaks directly to the devil with strength that comes from God himself, strength of eternity. He says, come out of him, you deaf and mute spirit, never enter into him again. And just for last licks, he throws the kid on the ground again. He shrieks and he goes back to where he came from. Go to hell, you devil. And he does. Compassion with God requires him to use his strength, because Jesus' arms are not too short to do anything in compassion. Jesus' arms are plenty long. He knows exactly what kind of compassion to have. He knows how to do battle with sin and death and the power of the devil, and he overcomes them not for his own good, but for the good of worried fathers and for jilted husbands and for mourning moms and dads and bereft relationships. Jesus dies so that we might experience his compassion and mercy. He himself has to go through the hell of being driven away from his Father, so that we might receive the compassion of a God whose arms are not too short for us. And what do we do? All that we can do is what this father in the story does. Jesus kind of gives him a little bit of comeuppance. If you can do anything, please have compassion on us. Have mercy. Jesus says, if you can, if you can, all things are possible for who? Not for me, he doesn't say. He says, all things are possible for one who believes. Who's that? That's you. And the man said, Lord, I do believe. That's why I'm coming to you. Lord, I do believe. I know that you can help. Lord, I do believe. Do your thing. Lord, we believe. But sometimes, because of the circumstances of this life, because of our shared dingy humanity, because of experiences that have left our hearts deadened and dull, we don't even think to ask. We take it upon our shoulders to fix the things that we're seeing as an issue. We see it as our burden and our responsibility, and we won't even bother to bother the Lord who has compassion for all of us. All things are possible for you because of him who is at work in you. I can do all things, St. Paul writes, through Christ who gives me strength. And what is that strength? It's the strength to hold on to him even when hope seems lost. Is to look to him even when it seems there's nowhere else to look. To call on him when you are all alone in your sin, all alone in your sadness and sickness. To look to him who is compassion, who is moved to mercy, who does use his strength and power on our behalf. You see, it's not only true of us, it's true of Jesus too. His strength is made perfect in his weakness. When he was weak on the cross, that's when he was strongest against the power of the devil. That's why Jesus was able to say, "It is finished." The reign of him who would take you down is over. But he's still looking for last licks. All things are possible for one who believes. Lord, we say it together. We believe. Help our unbelief. Of course he does. And shows his power in the mercy that he gives to us under every affliction that we have, forgiving our sins, strengthening our faith, and preparing us for the feast of victory, which is soon to come. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise. Now may the peace of God that passes all of our human understanding keep your hearts and minds calling out to him whose power is made perfect in his compassion. Amen. We're moving on into the hymnal part of the service, so if you need that, that's now the time to take out those books. It's hymn number 849, Praise the One Who Breaks the Darkness.
Praise the One Who Breaks the Darkness.
baptized into Christ Jesus and living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith by the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Be seated for prayer. You know, the fellow that was calling out to Jesus from the crowd, the dad in that story, he may have thought he was just talking to a teacher, but really what he was doing was praying to God. All of the things I've tried haven't worked. Can you do anything? That's prayer. And so we do that in the same spirit of the Father. This is why we open the congregation to prayer requests and ask people to share with us what the Lord has laid on your hearts. We want to come to our gracious God along with you to call on him to have mercy and show that compassion by his power and strength. So I invite the congregation to submit those prayer requests anytime, anywhere. Best is by email, prayer@spalutheran.org, that gets those requests into the hands of people who have promised to pray. Usually during the Sunday prayers, we also have a time for you to have a moment to speak your concerns out loud to God today. I'm not going to do that because, well, we're moving through the service. We need to move at a quicker rate. So we're going to just bear those things in mind as we come to God in this way. But don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. That fellow had boldness before God. That father knew that he should be asking Jesus for help. So should we. And so we call upon him in every need. We pray and praise and give thanks. So bearing these things in mind, let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lord God, we believe. Help our unbelief. Sustain us through many troubles and trials of this world, when unclean spirits afflict us and those that we love revive our trust in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, since your word reminds us that those who teach in the church will be judged with greater strictness, bless the pastors of your church, as well as all the instructors of schools, colleges, and seminaries. Keep them faithful to your word, that they may not stumble in what they say. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord and Father, tame our tongues so that they will not be a restless evil full of deadly poison. By the gracious work of your Spirit, turn from them cursing the people made in your likeness to instead blessing you, and keep us from stumbling in what we say. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, guard the tongues of our governing authorities, especially in this season when candidates are seeking election to public office. Reign and train their tongues to speak with true wisdom and to lead in accord with your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, you had promised that all things are possible for one who believes. In such faith, we bring before you those who have requested our prayers and all the others in need, asking you to grant them healing, health and healing. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving Lord Jesus, you suffered unjustly for our sins, but we were vindicated in your resurrection. Be near to us in your body and blood, and strengthen our faith by this holy meal, that no one can contend against those who have been reconciled to God through your grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things that we have asked, and whatever else you see that we need, Heavenly Father, we pray for the sake of him who died and rose again, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please rise as we approach the table of the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, holy. Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And again after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. O Christ, thou Lamb of God, that takest away, take and eat the body of Jesus Christ, broken for you.
Thank you.
unto the Lord, for he is good.
And his mercy endures forever.
Let us pray together. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you, in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Speaking of fervent love for one another, we want to show that love directly to Chris and Heidi Underwood as we are going to bid them farewell and Godspeed as they make a new chapter in Virginia. Heidi, Chris, come forward, please. All the way up. Chris, Heidi, our beloved brother and sister in Christ, in holy baptism, you were made members of the body of Christ. And among us here at St. Paul's, the Lord has nourished you through his word and his sacrament for several years now. But now we must bid you farewell and Godspeed as you begin a new chapter of life in Virginia. So please hear and take to heart these words of the Apostle Paul.
I thank my God in all my remembrance of you.
It's
always
right here.
In every prayer of mine for you, making my prayer with joy. Because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, and I am sure of this, he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Let us pray together.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for Chris and Heidi, and for your enduring faithfulness to them. Bless, protect, and defend them as they move to a new home. Even though we will be apart, keep us in the unity and love of the body of Christ until the day we gather with all your saints in the endless joys of your heavenly kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now, before we part company, the congregation has one more thing to say to you. People of St. Paul's, please raise your right hands in blessing. Please face your brothers and sisters in Christ over Chris and Heidi and over each other and say the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Before our closing hymn, there's one more thing. You are already making forays down into Virginia over the past couple of months, and we have slowly but surely become, well, accustomed to the notion that you might not be here. And this prompted in us a desire to honor you for the great and faithful ways that you have served in the congregation. Back in June, we had a congregational meeting, and every year since 2015, we have been awarding the Servant of Christ Awards, but you weren't here, because you were in Virginia. So we'd like to do that today. For a moment, let's have a congregational meeting. Whereas the 2024 nominees for St. Paul's Servant Leader Award demonstrate a spirit that is joyfully and perpetually ready to exemplify what our Lord spoke to his disciples, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And whereas that serving has readily and willingly been devoted to young and old, to friend and stranger, to those in want and those in plenty, inside and outside the congregation. And whereas our nominees have led by example, inspiring and enabling other congregational leaders to embrace Christ-like servanthood, to serve by leading and to lead by serving. And whereas the God-given spiritual qualities of joy, and humility, and mercy, and gratitude continue to grow prominent in those who serve alongside our nominees. And whereas our nominees, possessing a strong sense of the Lord's vocation, responded early to the Spirit's urging to selflessly devote their time and their energies to the well-being of St. Paul's and to those who worship here. And whereas much of the good done by nominees, our nominees, goes without recognition except by our God who sees in secret, therefore be it resolved that this congregation recognize Christopher and Heidi Underwood as the recipients of St. Paul's Servant Leader Award for 2024 with praise and thanks to God. And be it further resolved that in celebration of their devoted service in Christ's name, we sing with applause, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. So that's our job now. Clap and sing.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
I can't let you go without hugging you, because we love you both very, 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 very much.
Thank you.
I want you to take these things and put them in a place where you're going to remember us, because we will not forget you. We love you so much, Chris. God's blessings to you. We have one piece of business to do. Singing Savior Again to Thy Dear Name We Raise, number 917 in your hymnals.
Gathered by God
to share the love of Jesus.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.